K97.5. This is Chris, and we're back this week with some hip hop for you. It's Tupac's birthday. Happy birthday, Tupac, and rest in peace. We have some California love. Hey guys, it's Chris, and I'm back with James in his tie-dye t-shirt this week for our weekly Q&A on episode 8, No One. But before we get started, I want to talk about something really quick. I had somebody ask a few Q&As back. Yeah. James had asked a question, and part of their question was I on the Amino Game of Thrones app? So I want to take a second to talk about Amino. This app is really, really cool. It is called Thrones by Amino, and they have several other specific apps too for areas of interest. But this is a GOT community. Spoilers are welcome there. It is only dedicated to Game of Thrones. This app is available on iOS and Android, and I'll leave some links in the description below for that, so be sure to download it. So this app's really cool. It's got a lot of features in one. You can use it like a blog form style app with news and posts. For example, I post a lot of videos there and chat with you guys in the comments about it, because you can actually embed YouTube videos on this app. It's got really cool features like polls. You can chat with fellow GOT fans and gain a following on there, and that's chatting with individuals and in specific chat rooms. And you can also explore a catalog and pick specific GOT areas that you are really interested in, such as certain characters or houses. So a really, really cool app all rolled into one. So anyway, check Thrones Amino out. Be sure to download it from the App Store. I will leave the links to the App Store in the description below. Remember, you can get that on iOS and Android. And be sure to follow me on there. I am Smokescreens. I will continue posting my videos on there as usual every week. And also, I will likely be doing something for episode 10 next week. Anyway, I just wanted to let you guys know about that. So let's get to the Q&A. Out on bail, fresh out of jail, California dreaming. Soon as I step on the scene, I'm hearing Hoochie screaming. Fiending for money and alcohol. The life of a West Side player with cowards die in a strong ball. Only in Cali will we riot, not rally to live and die. In LA, we wear chucks, not ballots. Yeah, I had a few people this week that didn't like me actually critiquing Game of Thrones.
They hated you critiquing it.
I know.
No, they hated your opinion.
Right. It's an opinion. I think
they want
that's
you
kind
just
of the
to
idea.
review. And keep your opinion out of it. I don't get that.
Right. I mean, that's kind of what a review is, I thought. But, you know, that's fine. Everybody has an opinion. But I'm pretty damn lenient on Game of Thrones. You know, there's a lot of little things I can nitpick that I really don't.
Well, and plus,
it was just basically two major things, and the rest of it I pointed out good stuff too.
Even when they swayed from the book, you have
killed absolutely. I am by no means, you know, a book purist as far as, you know, the show not being like the books and all that. Never have been, never will be. I mean, I understand they're two separate things, but there was just a couple things that didn't make sense as far as the continuity. So, I mean, I have to point it out. I'm not going to lie about it.
Well, we all love Game of Thrones.
Oh, yeah. Still my favorite show just because it had a couple bad scenes.
Yeah. And so, you know, we all have different opinions, but we're all here for one reason, and that is Game of Thrones.
Damn right.
All right, I'm starting off with a question from Alec from Patreon.
Awesome. Thank you, Alec.
Question says, Q&A. So it's the Battle of the Bastards. One would assume Jon versus Ramsay, which is happening, but usually the names of episodes have more than one meaning. Tommen is eligible, and the Sand Snakes are also eligible. What if they come kill him? Do you think this could happen? They've had a ton of time, Game of Thrones wise.
Yeah, I think it's possible. I mean, I think for this particular episode, episode nine is typically the big episode for the season with the big event, whatever that may be. And I think the majority of this, if not all of it, I hope the whole damn thing is, you know, devoted to this battle in the north. So I think it primarily, you know, represents, you know, Ramsay versus Jon, but yeah, I mean, there's a chance of that. I'm just not sure we're going to see any more of Dorne as far as the Sand Snakes this year. I think we'll see Varys probably head to Dorne. I don't know if we'll see that this year now, since we got a lot to wrap up and two episodes left. But yeah, I mean, there's a potential for that, sure, because apparently they're still roaming around King's Landing. There's been no evidence to say they got in their Star Trek transporter and headed back to Dorne. You know, they want to cause chaos. They hate the Lannisters. So I can see that as a possibility where they kill Tommen. But I think right now I also see the possibility of Cersei accidentally, maybe purposely killing Tommen when she goes for the wildfire, because that's where the big cash is under the Sept of Baelor. You know, she can no longer have a trial by combat. That was taken away because the mountain rips somebody's fucking head off like a predator.
And I loved your Predator piece in there.
Yeah, I mean, that's the first thing I thought of. You know, I mean, I just saw, like, damn, he did that shit Predator style. Yeah, I love the Predator sound effects. And so I think it's more likely, you know, I think it could be a shout out to that, but I just don't expect to see the Sand Snakes in the last two episodes this season. But, I mean, yeah, it's possible because that would be the Battle of the Bastards. All the Sand Snakes are bastards. And, of course, Tommen, we know, is a bastard, being Jaime and Cersei's kid versus actually Robert. So, yeah, I mean, a good point. Could be.
This is another Patreon person, obviously. Sean Shiflett. It says, Q&A, is there any significance with the Hound meeting up with the Brotherhood Without Banners? What do you think the Hound will do next?
Yeah, I actually like this idea. You know, Clegane Bowl has been the hype for seasons now. But actually, I like this idea of him being something, being part of something bigger. Like, he's been told three times now, like I said in the review this week, he's been told by Beric twice now, and Brother Ray, which was the elder brother, whatever, in the show, that got hanged last week. And he went on his little vengeance thing for a few minutes, but then he kind of sat down with them and was like, hey, the cold winds are rising in the north. We need to head up there for the real threat, because they do, they see themselves as protectors, you know, the Brotherhood Without Banners, which is why it was so shocking to see that village get murdered.
Yes.
Because that was just a little rogue splinter cell of that group. So I think it's a good thing. I actually like the idea, but I mean, I would love to see Clegane Bowl, and maybe somehow he can get south for a reason, you know, quickly and run into his brother and kill him or whatever. But I think it's a better story for him to continue this. He's tried to escape violence. He can't really do it because you can't get away from it with all this damn war going on and all these people vying for power. But if he can fight for something bigger than himself, that's a great story for him. You know what I mean? So I would love to see the Brotherhood and the Hound end up beside Jon Snow in the Battle for the Dawn. I think it'd be cool. I'm liking that idea.
Hell yeah.
I'm actually liking that idea better than Clegane Bowl as far as the story goes.
I can agree with that.
You know what I'm saying? So.
Yeah. Sticking with the Patreon thing, let's go to Demetrius M. It says, hold over from last week. So you weren't impressed with the writing for the Bravos plotline. I gotta agree that the holes in Arya's character were huge. What do you think of the idea Jaqen and the Faceless Men had this track in mind all along? Jaqen acknowledged her kill list at the end of season 2. This episode, he went from dead fish face to smile when she said she is heading home. What are the odds they wanted her for the access and persona she had, vice being no one?
No, I think, you know, like I said a minute ago, I think Jaqen probably knew, you know, she was never going to be a faceless man or an assassin, because you got to think about it. You know, she helped him escape back in, you know, when they were on the way to the wall, ended up at Harrenhal together. You know, he owed her 3 lives and paid for those and got her out of there. And then it was completely her choice to come to Braavos in the first place. You know, he gave her the coin, said, hey, if you ever want to find me, you know, go say Valar Morghulis to anybody that's a Braavosi. They'll know what you're talking about. And she did that. But she chose to do that. So when she got there, she just didn't really have a place to go. She had this kill list. And she liked the idea of just going off to another area, getting away from all this stuff, you know, of her family dying. You know, as far as she knows, everybody's gone. I think what it boils down to is he knew it's, you know, she had skill or she was special in some way. And we thought that was going to be the warding thing, you know, because in the book she does ward.
Right.
So we thought, so I think it could have went either way. Like, he would have been happy to have her as assassin, as a faceless assassin, because she would have been damn good at it, especially if they threw in the warding stuff in the show.
Yeah, no shit.
But at the same time, if she ended up, I think he also kind of knew that she had been through a lot of shit. But you can come over here and learn some of this stuff, and then you can probably use that for your...
Yes.
Because either way, it doesn't matter to the many-faced God. That's what he always says. It doesn't matter. Either way, you know, faces are going to be added to the hall. Either way, you're going to die. So I don't think he cares as far as which path he, you know, she chose. I just think he was there to help, you know, in that regard. So I think he expected that. As far as the plot line goes, the only thing that made this bad wasn't necessarily the Terminator T-1000 chase scene or her trying to fight her in the dark. The points I had made to some people in the comments already were, if it wasn't for the episode where she blew out the candle and it looked like she knew she was going to be chased.
Yes.
She got needle.
Yes.
She hit it. She blew out the candle. She was hiding out. And then the next episode, she's walking around, not a care in the world, hands behind her back, you know, making a scene, throwing money around. That's what bothered me and most people. Not the fact that there wasn't a great fight necessarily. Yeah, I wanted to see her cut the wife's hair off and kill her.
Yeah.
But my point to a lot of commenters previously this week was, in the books, the blindness is not a punishment. It is part of her training. She can get her sight back anytime just by asking.
Oh, okay.
And in the show, it is kind of made out to be more of a punishment because she wore a face before she was ready or whatever. But at the same time, you got to assume that that's very similar and that they all go through that because she did train with it. They made it a point to train her blind, as you know, with stick fighting and all this other stuff. So it is a training tool, and you have to assume that the waif went through the same training.
Yeah, but you have to assume that.
But she is essentially a senior student, whatever she is. She's already wearing faces. She's got permission to do that. It doesn't make her blind now. She's much more advanced than Arya, obviously. She whipped her ass at every turn, almost. Arya got in a few good licks here and there as she started getting better. But I just see her as a more seasoned, faceless trainee, if that makes sense. True. That's all I was saying, is the consistency of her character from hiding out with Needle, blowing the candle out, knowing she's being hunted, to then acting like, well, I'm just going to go steal some gold or silver and go home.
That doesn't transition well.
That did not transition well.
To the city scene in broad daylight.
Right.
There was no
in-between. And then acting surprised when she gets stabbed on the bridge. That was the problem I had with
it. Why wouldn't that aggravate anybody?
That's all it really was. And so it came out on this episode, I guess, but it really was the combination of both episodes.
Yes.
Because there was no continuity there with her character, the way she was acting. That's all I really meant by that. And everybody thought there's got to be a twist. It's either Arya's got, you know, dual personalities, the whole Fight Club idea that came out, you know, this is really her killing herself to be no one, or, you know, it's not Arya, it's Jaqen. All these things, we expected some kind of payoff because she wasn't acting right. So that's where it got frustrating. That's all it really was. It was the combination of both, but I just happened to kind of ran on it for this particular review because it just didn't make sense.
Now, at the beginning of your response to this, you said something about her and Jaqen meeting up at Harrenhal. Is that what you said?
Mm-hmm.
All right, is that the place where I'm at now where she is fetching water for the...
For Tywin, right.
Tywin Lannister?
Yes.
Well, I'm going to tell you right now, I hate those guys that are torturing those people with rats.
Yeah, that's the tickler. That's the first on her list.
That's terrible, man.
That's the first on her list. And those are the Mountain's men, and they're horrible.
Oh, that is. When she said name three people? That's right. That's who she said.
Right. The tickler.
The tickler. That's horrible, man. Right. I felt so bad for those people.
So, yeah, that was another thing, you know, that came up last week with this whole thing. You know, a lot of people were saying, well, maybe, you know, Jock can let her go because he owes her a life. But, you know, we mentioned this last week.
Yeah.
He paid for those. So he actually gives her more than that is actually owed to her.
I thought that was really cool when she said, I don't know his name. And
right.
She said, particular, I guess. He said, good enough. That's good enough. And I was like, yes.
Right.
Man, he's awesome. I can't wait to see how his character unfolds for me.
Right.
All right, here we go. Patreon, Mark Joseph, a.k.a. The Snow in Winterfell. Q&A, do you think we will finally get confirmation of R plus L equals J in episode 10? Supposedly, Middle Ned plays a significant role in the episode. Also, with all the talk of the huge battle in episode 9 from the showrunners, do you think they were able to keep it under wraps that we will get another huge battle in episode 10. It looks like we will get dragons and krakens and Unsullied in the Battle of Meereen. Not sure which I'm looking forward to more at this point.
Yeah, I think we probably will. That may be a cliffhanger, but I think this is the way it's going to go down in general, is episode 9 is going to primarily be the Bastard Bowl in the North.
Okay.
Right, you know, Ramsay and John and the whole thing, and the veil comes in and all that good stuff. So I think we see that primarily, and that will probably take up, I would say, at least half the episode, I hope.
Mm-hmm.
But there is a lot of stuff to wrap up, although we do have, you know, continuing to season 7. We will see a little bit of Bran, possibly some White Walker stuff, but I definitely think RLJ will be revealed, at least to the audience, not to John yet, because I'm not sure if he finds that out, if he's got time for one episode to somehow relay that to John, whether it's you know, through a dream or physically traveling somewhere or whatever, because he should be able to send visions and stuff like that. We'll see how they do that in the show. But we know that happens because Bloodraven sent visions to him, you know, in the beginning. You know, it started in season one with the Three-Eyed Crow. So I'm thinking that he and Hallen Reed perhaps will be the ones to break it to John and verify that. So I think we may find out, but John won't for a while. But, of course, the other option is he goes in there, Lyanna dies, you know, she says, promise me, Ned, and we see a baby, and it goes off.
I can see that.
You know, so I can definitely see a cliffhanger there to kind of get us going for season 7 as well. But also see in episode 10 them wrapping a few things up. So I think we do see the Battle Marine.
Okay.
I think we see that get resolved somehow. Maybe a deal is made with Yara and Theon to overtake Euron and his forces somehow. Varys is now left. I know he's going to make arrangements in Westeros, and I think that's probably going to be Dorne. It may have something to do with the books where he goes to King's Landing to take care of a few things, let's just say. And so we got to see that, and I think we may see Dany actually headed to Westeros at that point.
Okay.
So I think there's a lot of things they need to do. I don't think we need to see Arya necessarily traveling. I think we'll just see her back in Westeros. They don't need to, you know, spend time on a ship or anything.
What about Sam? I mean,
Sam maybe getting to Old Town. There's a lot of stuff here, you know, that they could bleed over to season 7, but they need to kind of wrap up a few things because we're wondering, like, Sam, all right, he left with the sword, Heartsbane.
An important sword.
His dad's going to be after that sword.
Exactly.
So there's a lot of stuff. And so, yeah, I'm thinking that episode 9, Battle of the Bastards, for the majority of it, we may see the Cersei thing in King's Landing already this season.
God, yes.
There's a lot of stuff. But this last episode is also going to be like an hour and 10 or 15 minutes. Ooh. So there's a lot of stuff that could happen. But, yeah, RLJ, I think we will learn, because there are supposed to be 3 big reveals this year from George R. R. Martin that will be book reveals, essentially. So I think we'll learn that, but not John.
Let me ask you this. What is the percentage that R plus L equals J is not true?
At this point,
you think it's 100%
I think it's... I would. 95% true.
So
5%.
If it comes out
5%, there's another baby there, like Daenerys, or there's a twin or whatever.
So you're saying if I'm sitting with you watching the episode and they reveal something else, you're gonna be damn shocked.
Oh, I'll be damn totally shocked, because like I said, I've done several videos on other theories, like the R plus L equals D, which is Dany. You know, her being at the Tower of Joy, because there is some questions. There's completely legitimate questions about her childhood, especially in the books. Now, the show is pretty straightforward. In the books, she always has these memories when she's younger, before she goes off with Drogo and becomes her own woman. She remembers home, and she sees this red door, this house with the red door. And she sees this lemon tree outside this window in this house with the red door.
Yes. I remember you talking about this.
In the books, it is insinuated that lemon trees cannot grow in the salty northern climate of Braavos. No trees. Okay. Now, there is a Sea Lord's palace who could have potential greenhouses and stuff like that, because these rich people can afford to import trees, but they would have to be in a greenhouse type thing to live. But we are reminded throughout the books that lemons equal Dorne. So that implies that Dany could have spent some time in Dorne as a child, and she's remembering some part of Dorne with a house with a red door and a lemon tree out front, because in several other chapters, not even Dany chapters, we're reminded lemons equate with Dorne.
Okay.
So there is some definite questions, and that's why I did those videos. I'm still open to those things, but now that I've seen season 5 especially, and even more now in season 6, RLJ for me is just, it's 95 to 99%. I mean, I would be totally shocked if it ended up being, you know, Dany or John has a twin. You know, a lot of people think John and Mira are twins. I don't buy that either, because in the books, at least, it is very clear that Mira is a Reed, the way she's described as a Crannygman, you know, short and all this kind of stuff. You can't go by actors in the TV show. John kind of looks like Mira in the show a little bit, so people thought, oh, they could be twins. You know, they're the two babies at Tower of Joy, because we had this bed of blood. It could have been twins, and that's why she died, because it was twins, too much blood loss. So that is legitimate arguments, for sure. But at this point, with all the hints last year, especially season 5, they really went out of their way to bring up Lyanna this year, too. And they also really made Rhaegar out to be a good guy versus this, you know, kidnapping rapist. So they really made a point to hammer that home. So for me, I mean, RLJ's all but confirmed.
So Robert wasn't the only one who thought he was a kidnapper and rapist. Everybody else was convinced because of Robert.
Basically, yeah. I mean, that was the story. That's how the story went. Yeah. You know, he kidnapped Liana. They never suspected Liana actually loved Rhaegar.
Well, this kind of bleeds right into this question. Jennifer Shanley Clark. She says, do you think we're going to get the rest of the Tower of Joy this season? And how will Jon find out who his parents are? I feel like Hal and Reed needs to make an appearance soon.
Yeah, I mean, like I was saying before, I think we will get the reveal. I think we'll find out. I don't think Jon will yet, because
we need Bran in the picture, right? He can kind of put the puzzle together.
Yeah, because he's the one in the vision. He's the one that's going to see, you know, Lyanna die in the bed of blood. And yeah, Hal and Reed, he's got to come vouch for it, because if
Bran
finds out...
Oh, yeah, because Bran could tell him, but if Halen, who's the only one there...
He's the only surviving, you know, man who was at the Tower of Joy, as far except for the baby himself. So if Bran sends Jon a vision, or, you know, says, hey, by the way, you know, you're Rhaegar's son and Lyanna's my aunt, nobody's going to believe that. But Hal and Reed was there, so yes. He's got to show up. And George R. R. Martin has said that he will, in fact, show up, at least in the books again. So I got a feeling we'll see him in the show. They did bring him out in the Tower of Joy and kind of made a point of him being the one who saved Ned.
Yeah.
So we'll definitely see him, I think, because otherwise it's just a rumor, you know. So we'll see. But yeah,
the
vision
of some crippled child or whatever.
Right. And how does he get that out there? You know. Yeah. He can tell Jon, but then what? You know. So how does that go down? But yeah, I think we get the reveal. I mean, again, it could be a cliffhanger, but I don't know if they'll do that or not, being that they've already shown us half of the Tower of Joy. They show us the second half and still don't finish it.
Hey,
I don't
with
see
these
that.
Writers, man.
Well, that's right. You never know.
Let's see. Zwayne Tremendous says, what's Zwayne up, Tremendous. Guys? Great review as usual.
Thanks,
Q&A.
Sir.
What's Varys up to? And is he a Targaryen or Blackfyre? He must have King's blood, as he was offered to the Lord of Light when he was a child and got his junk cut off.
Right.
Who will save the day in Snowball? Littlefinger, Bran, or would it be decided by one versus one, as Jon said in the trailer? Peace out.
Yeah, I think Jon will offer the one versus one, you know, settlement with Ramsay. Ramsay's not going to take that fucking deal. Jon's an honorable guy. Ramsay wouldn't live up to that thing as far as the, you know, fighting honorably 101 to decide the battle without everybody dying. So that ain't going to happen.
Okay.
That will be rejected immediately. As far as the battle goes, I think it's going to go down pretty cliche. It's one-sided. Jon's going to be close to losing. They're going to be backed up by the Bolton army, and here comes the Veil at just the right time. Although they are in Moat Caitlin right now, as far, I think he said he had 10,000 men. I think that was the whole thing with Sansa and Littlefinger's, the letter she sent to him.
Yeah.
It was confirmed. It was Littlefinger she sent that to. And as far as...
Varys. Is he Targaryen or Blackfyre?
Yeah, I think there's something up with Varys. I think, you know, he keeps his head shaved. It reminds me of Egg from the Duncan Egg novels. This is young Aegon V who went by Egg. That was Aemon.
Oh, okay.
That was Aemon Targaryen, the maester at the wall. Maester Aemon, that's his brother.
Yes.
So this was like 100 years, this novel here, or the set of novels, was about 100 years before our story. So he went around with Sir Duncan the Tall just to go on adventures and learn he was his squire, but he was going to be the king eventually. He didn't know that. He was called Aegon the Unlikely because There was so many people in front of him in a line of succession. Maester Aemon turned it down. Egg became Aegon V.
Okay.
So I think there's something up with Varys. In the show, I think he is completely loyal to Dany, because there is no other aspect, as far as in the books, we have another character called Young Griff or / Aegon or Fagon, whatever you want to call him. He is supposedly the real Aegon Targaryen that survived the sack of King's Landing. Apparently, Varys smuggled him out. And Varys and Illyrio, you know, are seem to be Targaryen supporters. But in the books, Varys seems to support Aegon. Now, we don't know if Aegon's a Blackfyre. I think he probably is. I think he believes he's a Targaryen, but I don't think they're telling the whole truth, because they're with Jon Connington and the Golden Company. And the Golden Company was founded by Bittersteel, which was Bloodraven's brother, half-brother.
Oh, shit.
He was a bastard of Aegon IV, just like Bloodraven, but he supported Blackfyres. Completely. So it is suspicious in the books. But I think Varys in the show, I think he does fully support Dany, because they completely cut the Aegon storyline. It's all kind of condensed into Dany alone. And when Viserys got killed as the rightful king, as far as they're concerned, as far as the Targaryen lineage, it went to Dany. And now I think he's just leaving to go make preparations. I think it may be Dorne, because we did get a little hint from Illyria Sand when she shanked Doran Martell, that we all hated, you know, that happened, where they just completely cut the Dorne storyline almost. Is she told Doran when he was dying, a weak man will never rule Dorne again. So to me, that shouted Dany.
Gotcha.
So I think Varys is headed there to make preparations, make allies for her but because a lot of people had suspicions, and I agree, he got to Meereen and met Tyrion once Dany was gone. Uh-huh. Never met her.
Right.
And then as soon he took off on his secret mission, and then she showed up.
Right after.
But he didn't know when she was coming back. So he had to go do what he's got to do regardless, because they don't know if she's ever coming back.
You sure it's not a Clark Kent Superman thing?
People actually thought there was something to that.
Are you serious?
Yeah, like you never see him in the same place at the same time. But I think it's pretty straightforward. Yeah. I think it's just that, you know, I got to go take care of this. Hopefully she comes back really soon. Okay. He couldn't wait, you know what I mean, necessarily, right. Depending on the plans that he has. So I think he just left because he didn't know that, like, the next day or the same day or whatever that was portrayed to be, that she was just going to show up on Drogon. They may go the route where he heads back to King's Landing and does a few things that happens in the book. Although I think that may be done a little differently in the show. So I think he's probably headed to Dorne, but there is a possibility he sneaks back into King's Landing and, let's say, make some arrangements. With Dany coming over, what does Varys need in Westeros to help Dany? He needs chaos, right, in King's Landing. So
next we have Lauren Wilson. She says, Q&A, next week is Bastard Bowl. Do you think the Knights of the Vale will storm in when all hope is lost? Or do you think another army might make an appearance as White Walkers?
Yeah, I definitely think the Vale. I think I mentioned that just a minute ago. I think the Vale shows up just in the nick of time. You know, that gets, you know, Littlefinger back in Sansa's good graces a little bit, you know, because he still needs her for the North. I mean, he's doing it to legitimately help her. I don't think he really knew how bad Ramsay was. But at the same time, he's in it for the power. He's using her just like he does for everything. So, yeah, definitely the Vale. I don't think we're going to see the White Walkers involved in that battle yet. I think it's just a tad, even though they're moving really fast in the show, and now apparently only two short seasons left, I don't think we're going to see White Walkers involved in that northern battle quite yet.
Okay.
I think we may see them possibly approach the wall in season or episode 10. Maybe that's another thing to kind of, you know, get us, you know, see them for season 7, where they like actually approach the wall, or Bran sees it coming down in a vision, maybe really coming down.
Yeah.
But they're not quite there yet. So
okay.
I think they really got to get this whole northern thing taken care of as far as being united under the Stark banner.
I would hope so.
And then they start bringing in the end game pieces as far as Dany and all those guys to start the big battle for the Dome. So.
Okay. Well, she ends with, P.S. I love you and all your videos. I watch you religiously. A little thumbs up.
Oh, thank you. Appreciate that.
This is from Kejdi Camberi. Q&A. Uncle Benjen was mixed with Cold Hands. Do you think then D&D will mix Blackfish with Stoneheart?
I don't think so. I just don't think the Stoneheart, you know, is going to be a story at all. I think
so. That's gone.
Yeah, really. I just think it's gone because
the opportunity's missed.
Yeah, I think it's too far. We're too far past that point of her being, you know. I mean, yeah, the Brotherhood. We clearly see that Beric's still alive, in charge of the Brotherhood. We literally saw the Hound piss in the river. I think that was a little shout out to say, because that's where they pulled her body from.
Okay.
So he literally pissed in the river saying, you know what, you're not getting Stoneheart. We've been teasing that shit for 4 years, you know, or whatever. Forget it. So I think we're kind of past the Stoneheart thing. I just think he's done. I just think he went out, you know. I mean, he could potentially be, you know, thrown in a river and somebody finds him and Beric gives him the kiss of life and brings him back. But I don't see them making the Blackfish, you know, a Lady Stoneheart type character. I don't think it's going to be a male version of a Lady Stoneheart, in other words.
Okay.
You know, that makes sense.
Yeah, doesn't make as much sense as Cold Hands.
Yeah, because Cold Hands, Benjen, I mean, that was an obvious thing to do in the show. Instead of having two separate characters up beyond the wall, it made sense for that to be Benjen. Even though George R. R. Martin said to his editor on a little note, when she asked about is Benjen Cold Hands in the books, he just marked no. Now, we all take that as it's not Cold Hands. Benjen's a completely different character. But he also could have been saying, I mean, I'm not saying it's true, I'm just speculation, but what if he's saying no, as in Benjen's dead, this is a different character now? You know what I mean? So it makes sense for those to be combined in the show, at least. But I don't think it really makes sense for the Blackfish to come back as a male Lady Stoneheart type of character. It just wouldn't have the same effect as a Catelyn who's been through all this shit and watched all their children die and shit, and especially Rob right there at the Red Wedding.
Did you say earlier that Sansa's letter definitely went to Littlefinger?
Yeah.
Definitely? Because Michael Coleman says, what if Sansa's letter sent a letter to Hal and Reed?
That would be interesting, but she wouldn't know anything about that other than stories. But yeah, no, somebody was able to flip that letter upside down and zoom in, you could really read it pretty damn clear. It definitely went to Littlefinger saying, you know, you camp here and offer the Army of the Veil, I'll take it, because we're pretty fucking desperate.
This question is from John.
All right. Damn. We got a John? Just John?
Just John. This is a Q&A. Why did Brienne of Tarth leave River Run? Why didn't she make the same offer to Edmure Tully to bring his Tully forces north to help Sansa Stark take Winterfell? After all, the Tully forces now have nowhere to go, and Jaime Lannister would be happy to pit three enemies of the Lannisters against each other, i.e. the Starks and Tullys versus the Boltons. The Boltons had betrayed the Lannisters by marrying Sansa Stark to Ramsay Bolton when she is wanted in King's Landing for murder of King Joffrey.
Yeah, this is part of the issue I had. I completely agree. This was part of, you know, I mentioned primarily in the review video, why waste a Blackfish like that? You know, why go out and have him killed when he could have said, okay, I'm going to go help my family. And by the way, the Tully words are family, duty, honor. Family comes first in their house words. He just forgot about that, apparently. But I guess that's why he's named the Blackfish, right? Like the black sheep of the family. But it was a waste for him not to take that army, I don't care if it was 50 or 100 men, whatever, and go help his damn family, the only people he's got left, right?
Mm-hmm.
So they had him go out and die off screen. Okay, well, Brienne was never, why did she run? You know,
I don't know.
She was there, you know, given permission by Jaime to go in there and negotiate. She could have walked out the door.
Didn't make sense to me either.
So she tried to escape and take the Blackfish, I guess, and they waved at each other. He wouldn't go. So
she's rolling down the river. Who's with her again?
Pod. Her
and
squire, Pod.
Jamie's up there waving at her.
Yeah, waves at her, and he could have easily called his men, and I understand that was kind of back to good Jamie again, letting her go. He's got feelings for her, wondering if he's ever going to see her again. But to me, it's like, I agree completely. Why not make that same deal? Why not go back to Jamie's tent and say, okay, the Blackfish died. He was a stubborn bastard. But now that Edmure's here, you want this castle, let me take Edmure and his men, because he is the lord of Riverrun, and go up north and have the same exact deal. And Jaime would have said, yeah, as long as I get this damn castle, I don't care. Because he was being asshole, Jaime, again, to Edmure with all those threats about his kids and stuff and wife, because he wanted to actually save people from bloodshed.
Well, explain
this
to me.
It just makes no sense.
It says, Jaime would be happy to pit three enemies of the Lannisters against each other, Starks and Tullys versus the Boltons.
Basically, the Starks have always been enemies since the whole thing went down with Tyrion. Mm-hmm. So that set up the Starks and Lannisters being enemies. Joffrey came into power and knew immediately the Starks are my enemies. Cut Ned's head off. That started the War of the Five Kings.
Right.
Or got Robin to the War of the Five Kings. The Tullys, their houses were joined to the Starks, so they're automatically anti-Lannister.
Okay.
They were involved in the Red Wedding. The Lannisters set that up, and they killed Catelyn and Robb and, you know, all that good stuff, and married Edmure and kept him hostage for five seasons or five or whatever the time was.
Yeah, this is all past. I haven't seen
this stuff. And then, of course, the Boltons, Lannisters and Boltons, made the deal for the Red Wedding, you know, that he would betray Robb and stab him at the Red Wedding and break those traditional guest rites. And then, of course, what happened was Sansa was the suspected in Joffrey's murder and was told not to marry Ramsay Bolton by the king, you know, by decree, right? So that automatically makes, now that Tywin has died and no longer handed the king, and now we have Tommen, they're automatically in dispute against Tommen and the crown, because they married Sansa Stark to Ramsay, and Sansa is a known wanted person. You know,
so, yeah, that does make sense.
Right.
Why not pit three of them together? So, Do you think they really missed out on something there, not having her go offer the same offer again?
I think so. I mean, just for the sake
going?
Of the story.
Where is she
Well,
going?
Now she's going back north to say, sorry, my lady, I couldn't bring anybody. Nothing. Yeah, I failed again.
That sucks.
Yeah, that's what I mean. It was just an ending that it could have been, not that those 50 or 100 men would have made a huge difference, but just to see it at a good resolution, nobody had to die. Jaime gets what he wants right now. He saves everybody from dying, from actually taking siege to the castle and all the whole war breaking out, which I knew that was coming. We knew there wasn't going to be a real fight there. But why not let these forces go up north and join the whole battle in the north? It just seemed to be a waste to me. Now, those Tully men are what? They're prisoners? Or are they just going to let them go home to their individual keeps or whatever and just hang out? I mean, what are they? Are they prisoners now of war somewhere? Because they were going to let him go under Brienne's deal with, you know, the Blackfish to the north. They were going to let him walk right out with their weapons. But now that changed. So it just didn't make sense to me as a resolution to that whole problem.
This question comes from Fenya Booyah.
Fenya Booyah.
Nice picture, Fenya. You look really pretty and happy. It says, here's a question I haven't heard anyone ask.
Okay.
Dany the Conqueror wins. She ascends the throne, Queen of Westeros and the world. Who will be her successor? She can't have children. Isn't it pointless?
I think she can't have children right now, but I think it's going to change. In the books, we're at a little bit different point. Before she, while she's in the Dothraki Sea with Drogon, she actually has a period, I believe. It's insinuated that it's a menstrual cycle because she finds herself bleeding down there.
Okay.
And that was part of the whole Miri Maz Dur thing, you know, when the mountains blow in the wind like leaves, when your womb quickens again and you bear a living child, that was part of this prophecy. Only then will you see Khal Drogo again in the sense of a Khalasar, that type of thing, I believe. So in the show, they did kind of insinuate when she lost Rhaego that she's not able to have children again, but she's not quite up to that point in the books yet. I mean, she is as far as being back in Meereen already, but they did skip the whole kind of menstrual cycle thing.
Okay.
So in the book, she actually does start to have a menstrual cycle again, so it's implied that she is now able to bear children. So I'm assuming that if that's important enough in the show, because I don't know if it really will be, because I think by the time we get to the end game, if there is a winner, if Dany is a ruler of the Iron Throne, as far as the Seven Kingdoms and the world for that matter, basically it's going to end and we're not really going to need to know who her successor will be as far as the show goes. But again, in the books, it's already to that point where we believe now that she could probably have children again.
Well, let me ask you this. If the show ends, and it ends as the most popular show on TV.
Right, which okay. I believe it will. Absolutely.
Do you see, in a few years, the demand still being there for them to come back out and reopen this?
Yeah, I mean, there's already talk of a prequel,
okay.
For sure. I mean, I think that will definitely happen. We don't know what it's going to be yet. I don't think they'll go any sequel route as far as
you
like
think
what
we'll
may
see Mad King?
I think it's either going to be Robert's Rebellion, which we would see the Mad King. This will be 14 years before this show started. So that would be where the Mad King, Aerys II's ruling, Lyanna would be in the story, young Ned, all that good stuff. So it'd be the same characters, very familiar faces, except for different actors and actresses, I'm sure.
Right.
But that would be the point where Robert, you know, where Lyanna supposedly gets kidnapped with Rhaegar, Tower of Joy, that whole thing. That kind of starts Robert's Rebellion, not really in itself, but then when Rickard Stark and Brandon Stark went to the capital to demand Lyanna's release, they got, you know, one got burned alive while the other choked himself to death. That's what really started Robert's Rebellion. Robert said, the hell of this. He called his banners, he joined with the Starks, and they all took over and did Robert's Rebellion.
Now,
so that would be an option. The other one I would say really quick would probably be possibly Aegon's Conquest, which will be 300 years before, and that's what everybody wants to see, Aegon coming up with three dragons conquering
Standing
Westeros.
Standing on the back of them.
In the first place, the only reason I don't see that possibly happening, and a lot of people think that it'll be just too much CGI with dragons, because as we see this year, we don't get to see a lot of dragons.
I know.
Or direwolves. They just kill them off, so.
Well, let me tell you this. You know, I've been catching up on the show, right?
Right. Season 2.
I am halfway on through season 2. Halfway through. So speaking of CGI and these dragons, they're really doing a good bit of it with what I'm seeing with the little dragon eating right. meat and like or whatever they're feeding right. them, and it's burning it and then eating it. And I'm
yeah,
thinking, why
I think,
can't they put that kind of budget into these now that it's got legs and it's the biggest show
ever? Right, yeah, there's no question that there's plenty of budget as far, but I guess it's the time it takes, I'm assuming. But
true.
They kind
true.
Of, in the first couple seasons, they kind of hooked you with some dragon stuff, right?
Uh-huh.
You got several episodes that go off with the dragon screeching, like when Danny's dragons were born.
Yes.
You hear, you know, and it goes off, and then several other ones will be like that, you'll see. So they're here and there and a little bit more, you know, around as far as being displayed in the show in the first few seasons. But then they kind of fade off a little bit as other stories take root and Danny's not as a big deal at certain times. So I would definitely like to see at least a prequel. I'm sure we will, because HBO is not going to drop that kind of money. I mean, they're not right. going to let this thing go and just end. They wanted to go 10 seasons. But I don't think Dan and Dave will be involved. I think they're pretty wore out, pretty done with it once season 8 ends.
I don't know if you remember a few Q&As back when I said, when I was asking you questions about pyromancers and the stuff mm-hmm. being stored under the city. What's that shit called again?
The wildfire.
Wildfire.
Right.
I actually saw Tyrion, the door get open. That old man showed him.
Right.
All those bottles and stuff they have of it. And it's getting me fired up where the guy was, Cersei was talking to the guy and said, are the rumors true? He said, oh, very true, something
right.
like that.
Yeah, he said something to the effect of, you know, the old rumors.
Yes.
You know, and you know, I had my little birds investigate, and she said, well, were they rumors or was it something more? He was like, oh, there's more, much more.
Much more.
But that's the thing, the wildfire you see in season 2 with Tyrion, he knows about that. He has it made for this purpose of Blackwater Bay. They don't know about the old caches.
You're right.
So this
is made for Blackwater Bay.
Right.
That's correct.
And
he
that's
said she's been having us work day and night.
And yeah. I don't know if you've got to the portion yet where he asks about how it's made and stuff like that, and the pyromancers say our spells are kind of working again because
yeah.
dragons are now back in the world. So
that, yes,
which enhances magic apparently. So
not trying to hog up all the time, guys. I just get fired up about this. Okay, next question. Devious Keeley. Cool last name. She has two questions.
Okay.
But I'm just limiting it to the first one, okay? It says, during the Battle of the Bastards, do you think a few houses that are on the side of the Boltons will pull a Battle of Falkirk and lay down their arms to aid the Starks? And if so, which houses do you think would still be loyal to the Starks?
I don't see that in the show. I see, you know, I would love the idea of at least the Umbers, you know, kind of pulling a turncloak and bullshitting Ramsay, but I just don't see it. I think they legitimately, in the show, made Small John an asshole, you
okay.
know, because he, you know, some people argued, and I would love to see this, that he brought in Rickon as a hostage, and he refused to bow to Ramsay, which is kind of a northern thing, you know, to bow and swear your fealty, and that's kind of a big deal.
Right.
And he refused to do that. And he's like, fuck all this. Basically, it's indicating that things are changing. But he brought in Rickon as a hostage, as a gift for Ramsay, and also had killed Shaggy Dog. So that's a very dangerous gamble to take with the Lord of Winterfell, presumably because they presume Bran being dead.
Okay.
So I just don't see that happening in the middle of the battle. Now, at the end of the battle, when I think what's going to happen does happen, you may see people, okay, we'll give up, you know, we yield.
Yeah.
But they really didn't include a lot of these other houses that we know of. I hope we see some Manderleys and things like that, but I couldn't imagine. So far, it looks like we have basically the Starks, the few Starks, which is really just Jon and Sansa. The Wildlings mm-hmm. is basically the Stark army.
Right.
You have now the Hornwoods. We've seen them in the trailers. We've seen their banners. We see, of course, the Mormonts with Lyanna Mormont, the badass little 10-year-old
yes.
who runs Bear Island with 62 men. And basically, that's it. You know, there's really no other houses. There's so many more in the books, you know, but they're not going to include all
those.
Are
you talking about that's it as far as the Northern Army?
Yeah, that's it. That's all that Jon and Sansa have, you know, really. And so they're really making this one-sided because, you know, so you, and then you have, of course, on the other side, the Boltons and their army and the Umbers and Karstarks. And that's really the three they're featuring as far as the northern houses. So it's really a one-sided thing. And I can almost see this coming. It's really a setup to me for the Veil to come swooping in at just the right time, because Sansa did write that letter to Littlefinger. Like, you know, I'm going to cash in this favor.
Who's the army or navy coming into the pyramid right now? And you saw Drogon flying off?
Yeah. Now, that's supposed to be the Yunkai masters. You saw the Yunkai symbol on their sails. So okay. that's the slavers in Slaver's Bay, the masters. Okay. She had went to city and conquered all each of these cities and basically banned slavery outright.
Okay.
So that's who's attacking there now. But on behind them, we should see, and I'm assuming a good time for that would be now, because we know how fast these people can travel in the show. We should see Yara and Theon and the Ironborn start to show up behind them.
Did those ships not have some badass weapons?
Yeah, that's what I said in the review. You had these, you know, Molotov cocktails being slung off and, you know, on a wooden ship. So, but it was pretty damn advanced weaponry for Game of Thrones, right?
It was.
So I was saying in the review, you know, Dany landed on the pyramid and was kind of, if you see these people attacking, you're on the back of a dragon.
You could
have wiped them out in 10 or 15 minutes.
And then went there and landed.
And then went and landed and said, by the way, I just saved the fucking city. What the hell's going on?
Y'all in here trying to tell jokes, you drunks.
Yeah. So, I mean, you know, and some people could argue, well, maybe she wants to try to take those ships because, and that's a possibility because she doesn't know the Ironborn's coming, but we do. We know Yara and Theon's going to show up and try to make a deal. We know, apparently, that Euron is behind them with 1,000 ships.
Exactly, yeah.
However fast they can get that done. So, you know, that could go a lot of different ways, but it was just, like, odd to me that she just landed, like, to ask questions before you take care of the ships that are bombing you. So
good point. I didn't even think about
anyway,
that.
Anyway, I mean, you have a dragon, you know. I don't know. I think that could probably take out a few ships.
I would
just
say
a few
so.
Minutes. And again, that's what I mentioned. That was one of the things I said in the review that kind of bothered me this week. Where the hell is Rhaegal and Viserion? Why are they not being shown? At least let us know that they're either still in the pyramids, one way or the other, or out somewhere.
True.
Because he let them go. He took their chains off, and people have said, well, they didn't necessarily leave the door open. Why did he go down there anyway in the first place? You think he's going to go twice to risk his life? He was already scared shitless. He told Varys to punch him in the face if he had an idea like that again.
Yeah.
So why, you know, if they were already in the city, you know, and again, this is a little comparison to the books, not that I'm bitching about it, but if they were at least out like they are in the books, because they're in the books, they are already in the city, like making nests in the pyramids and shit, or their lairs.
Really?
They could have just went and, oh shit, we got company. So anyway, I mean, it was just one of those little frustrating things. It didn't make any sense for continuity because he let the dragons out, but yet we hadn't seen him in, what, not 8 episodes now, I think? Something like that. So anyway.
All right. Amy Travis says, Q&A, what do you think of Jack and smiling when Arya reclaimed her name? Do you think it was part of the plan all along for her to not be no one, but to use her training to have the ability to be anyone when needed?
Yeah, I basically think, you know, I agree with that. You know, that's one of the things I did like about the Arya scene was just the end. You know, when he, you know, came up to Arya, you know, and she's like, you know, you told her to kill me. Yes, I did, but here you are and here she is. And she says, I'm Arya Stark of Winterfell and I'm going home. And he kind of looked like it was a nod of approval.
It did.
So now she's off the hook. She can walk out of there without worrying about other people chasing her down. But yeah, I think he kind of knew the whole time. I mean, we all expected her never to be no one. And so, hell, we don't even know who Jacken is. I mean, we just call him Jacken because that's the character name that we've been given. So,
we
don't know whose real face he's got or what he really looks like. And in the books, it's a little different. It's an old man they call the Kindly Man. So there are several others in the books. But I think overall that he knew the whole time, and that was kind of his nod of approval. Here, we've given you some tools. Now you can go, you know, pay homage to the many-faced god and add all these faces on your list to the hall, you know, directly, because obviously she'll be on a different continent, but appease the many-faced god of death and take care of your list. And by the way, we gave you some skills along the way.
Ralph Hartley says, Q&A, what do you think is next for Arya?
If I had to guess right offhand, it would probably be she's heading to the Riverlands and probably to the Twins for the Water Frey kill. And I just say that because we have a scene apparently in season 6, and we only have 2 episodes left, where Walder Frey and some, you see some Lannister soldiers in there. They seem to be celebrating the fact that they got River Run back. So there's really no reason for that scene to be there, just for him to say, yay, we got it back, big deal. I would say that I would ultimately like to see her meet up with the Brotherhood again and the Hound. That would be cool. Perhaps that's, you know, what leads her back to Winterfell. She did say, I'm Arya Stark from Winterfell and I'm going home.
True that.
So maybe with now the Brotherhood Without Banners being kind of connected to the War for the Dawn, hearing about the, you know, cold winds rising in the north, perhaps that's her route to get back to Winterfell and kind of join up with Sansa and Jon and all her siblings that she don't even know if is alive or dead. So, but right offhand, I mean, there's a possibility, you know, of King's Landing. Cersei's on her list, obviously, but I wouldn't bet on that right now, because I don't know if Cersei's going to make it that far for her to be still on her kill list, if that makes sense.
It does.
So anyway, I mean, it's hard to say. I mean, but I would guess that based off that scene, probably the twins.
Here's a cool one that I'm interested in your take.
All right.
Q&A. Oh, from Kevin Price. Sorry. Q&A. I was listening to a Game of Thrones podcast. Two contributors agree that they don't see much or any change in Jon Snow post-resurrection. I personally see a big change in him, especially mentally. He lacks all the leadership qualities he displayed. It says post-death, but I'm sure they meant pre-death, and he seems mentally weaker. Quotes, a broken man.
Right.
I would say he is the mentally weakest of all the Starks at this point, and it's tough for me to watch since I've been in this corner since day one. What do you think? Do you see these changes as well?
Yeah, I agree. I think, you know, I had said I didn't think he'd be that much different, and he's really not in the sense of, you know, remembering things, who he is, and all that
right.
stuff. But at the same time, he is mentally different because, you know, he was so focused on the White Walkers and the Battle for the Dawn, and he knew what was coming. He got the wildlings through the wall to unify everybody. And then he comes back from the dead. He sees nothing. That changed him for sure. And ever since then, he's kind of, it's almost like people have forgotten about him.
Yeah.
We've been so focused on King's Landing and River Run and, you know, and Braavos and all that stuff that he had to be kind of talked back into, or even going back to Winterfell to get his home back after he was essentially released from his vows, you know, via dying, you know, via death.
Yeah.
And he's just like, okay, yeah, you're right, Sansa. We need to go take our home back. So he seems like he's worried. He's not confident. So he is different. I see that for sure. And it's almost like, what now? But I think that's going to come after Winterfell's retaken. I do think they win this war. Melisandre did see herself walking on the battlements of Winterfell and you know, Bolton banners burning. So ultimately, I think that after they take this back, their attention is going to be refocused on the White Walkers coming and all that kind of stuff. And that may be because of Bran or LJ.
Mm-hmm.
And then at some point, and this is not going to be this season by any means, or probably even season 7, but season 7 going into season 8, his importance will be known to us. Why is it so important that he is an Ice and Fire baby?
Okay.
You know what I mean? If that makes sense. So
does.
I think right now it's going to be like he's kind of back to just all about the Starks for a little while, getting his family back together, getting his castle back. Then something's going to trigger him to be refocused on the real threat. He knows they're coming, and Davos actually mentioned that speaking to Lyanna Mormont. You know, the dead are coming, and that's what the real war's about. We got to unify the North in order to have a chance.
Okay.
So it's still there, but on his mind. But yeah, he doesn't seem as focused. But I think that's going to be a contrast for later. That's just my take on it, because there is something about him being the result of Rhaegar and Lyanna, Targaryen and Stark, you know, he's the key to stop whatever's coming in some way, if that makes sense.
No, it does.
So
it does.
And that may be some kind of treaty or truce, or he has to do something that's bittersweet.
Do you think he needs that reveal to happen to trigger something in him to say, wait a minute,
right.
I am this
right.
Fire and ice,
you know,
baby.
A lot of people think that may have something to do with being the king, you know, because he will have a claim that will be stronger
right.
than Dany's.
Yeah.
Because he will be the son of Rhaegar, and it depends on if he's still a bastard and stuff like that. But yeah, I think that's what the change is going to be.
Yeah, I think it will. If I heard that, I'd be like, wait a second.
Right, I think the RLJ reveal will change him back to caring. Because right now, he told Melisandre in the preview for episode 9, if I fall, don't bring me back. Like,
yes,
he don't give a shit.
Yeah.
But once that's revealed that he's got a greater importance and that he is right as far as his focus on the War for the Dawn, I think that brings him back to the kind of a leader, Jon Snow, that we know. So
okay.
Hope that made sense.
Here's Anish Bhattacharya. Anish asks 3 questions. I'm going to ask you the second one.
All right.
Who are the 3 that are going to ride the dragons? I got Dany as Drogon, and for the other 2, I can't get clear sight among Bran, Meera, Jon, R plus L equals J, and Tyrion. Okay, so he has a little something in parentheses. It says, Bran, you will fly.
Right.
Meera,
right.
Then it says, Jon, R plus L equals J, and Tyrion, secret Targaryen, question mark.
Yeah, I mean, at this point, I would, you know, definitely Dany. She's already
right.
riding him. She's already riding Drogon. She's bonded with him the most. I would, if there's going to be 3 dragon riders, the dragon has 3 heads, which, you know, could or could not mean actual riders. I would guess Jon, Dany, and Tyrion. And that's pretty cliche at this point, but the Tyrion thing, it kind of showed us that. Me and Val had kind of predicted this before the season.
Yep.
That he would have a kind of a moment with him where they dug him or bonded or whatever you want to call it. And that's kind of what happened. I mean, he went down there and they like, yeah, you're cool. Here, let my shit off too. So I kind of like the idea, and another YouTuber, Tony Teflon, pointed this out a long time ago in a video he did, I think, was the colors of the dragons, I think, mean something. And I think he's spot on. I think you have Rhaegal with green and gold, golden pools of eyes and stuff like that, which represents Lannister gold type of thing, ties in with Tyrion. And then you have Viserion, who is a cream-colored dragon. If I had to guess at this point, I would just guess, obviously, Dany, Tyrion, and Jon. But then again, a lot of people think Bran will ward one. But is that going to happen so neatly where there's 3 dragon riders and they go off and save the day against the White Walkers? Or will there be some turn of events where dragons are fighting other dragons? We don't know.
Well, man, I think that pretty much wraps it up. This wasn't that exciting of an episode. I do believe you made the Q&A way more exciting than the episode that it went with.
No, again, I know a few people, and it wasn't very many people. I think most people agreed that this was a kind of a subpar episode for Game of Thrones. It doesn't mean that I hate the show.
Hell no.
You know, I love the show. I'm pumped about this Sunday, just like I will be every Sunday that it comes on. But there was just a couple things there that I pointed out, and it just, for me, it was just my opinion that didn't make sense how they wrapped their storylines up. River Run being one of them. And Arya, the payoff was just odd. And it was based off, again, how she acted the previous episode when she was hiding out and all that stuff. And so that's what was the inconsistency. So it was almost like, in that particular critique of that scene, it was critiquing episode 7 and 8.
Because I remember when that scene happened where she blew the candle out, you were kind of like, oh, hell. It was almost like she was going to lay in wait.
Yeah.
You know?
Yeah, and I understand a lot of people had mentioned this as far as I was complaining about this whole buildup between the waif and her, you know, the waif's being a jealous asshole, and why she get to have personal feelings about Arya being no one when she shouldn't care either way. But she got this, Jaqen promised her, hey, let me kill her. So this was obviously a test for her too. But again, it was just the idea that she was hiding out and in the dark, and I got the whole dark thing, but I told a few people in the comments, to me, in the books at least, and I know the show's not the books, but in the books, the blind training is training. It's not a punishment. In the show, it was more like a punishment, but at the same time, they still used it as training.
Yeah.
Because they clearly went through the montage of her getting her ass beat with sticks while she's blind and all that stuff. So you assume that the waif went through the same thing. So it made no sense. It was no real advantage if that happened. for Arya to go and plan on fighting her in the dark, is all I was saying.
True. I was wanting to run up to a wall and paint a fake tunnel on it.
Yeah, Looney Tunes.
See the waves go wham!
Fucking Roadrunner and Coyote. That'd be awesome.
Oh, shit. But man, listen, thanks for letting me do all this stuff.
Oh, yeah, man. I love
thanks
these.
Thanks for all your help behind the scenes that you don't know. Guys, I'm texting this guy at 2 in the morning saying, what's happening, man? I'm on season 2, and he has no problem talking to me and helping me out, man. And I
yeah,
love
I think that's what everybody's saying. We all, it's like we love seeing somebody new to the club.
Yeah.
Going through all that we went through watching or reading or whichever it is, but in this case watching, and it's just so awesome because now when you get caught up, we can talk about it all.
Well, I just want to say this for everybody and say it loud and clear. I'm halfway through season 2. Fuck you, Joffrey. I hate your fucking guts. I hope you die.
Yeah.
That's all I got to say about it. I hate
that's how we all felt exactly. I think we'd all agree. All
right. Thanks for having me on here.
Yeah, no, I enjoy it. Thanks for coming for another Q&A, and we'll keep these going even after the season. Anyway, guys, that's it for us. Thanks for watching as usual. Again, check out the links below for the Amino Thrones app. That's really cool. Find me on there as Smokescreen. So anyway, as usual, thank you guys on Patreon for the support. I really, really appreciate it. And thank all you guys for all the support. It's really appreciated. It means a lot. Be sure to subscribe to Get Everything. Thanks for watching, and we'll see you next time.